I was the wireless operator in the Stirling crew of which Flight Sergeant Middleton was captain. Even while the action was on, I remember thinking, I'm watching this, not a part of it. It was like seeing a film of a burning house. Somehow it never enters your head that you personally won't come out of it alive. I hope this explains why some of the details may not be quite clear. I've remembered them as if they were in a film I'd seen some time ago. Ron Middleton was an Australian and lived most of his life on his father's sheep station, Linang, at Bogan Gate in New South Wales. He was 26 years old and about the most modest chap I've ever met, and at the same time, good-looking. He was so efficient that the three gunners of his crew had asked to be allowed to continue to fly with him, even though they had completed their tour of operations. They were with us on this trip to Turin. After dusk, we got the green light from the aerodrome control pilot in his caravan by the runway, and Middleton opened the throttles, and we took off. Over France, Middleton noticed that the Stirling, H for Harry, was using up a lot of fuel in climbing. We were detailed to go down low over Turin to attack the Fiat works, and that meant we should have to climb twice to get over the Alps, so we were naturally very careful about the consumption of fuel and climbed slowly to economize. By the time we reached the Alps, we had climbed to 12,000 feet. There was no moon, and we should normally have crossed the Alps several thousand feet higher. But Middleton decided to go on and make his way through the mountains. The front gunner was told to watch ahead, and everyone in the bomber began looking up at the sides of the mountains. We could see patches of snow, white among the dark shadows, and there was an anxious moment when the shadows closed in and the front gunner reported, "Mountains straight ahead." Middleton said, "We're coming to a dead end." He opened the bomb doors, and the navigator was about to jettison the bombs so that we could climb to safety when the front gunner called out, "It's there. Look to starboard." Far to the right and below us, we could see the lights of Turin and British flares blazing in the sky above the city. We closed our bomb doors and turned to fly down this pass. Middleton again asked about the petrol, and the flight engineer said that if we went down low, we might not be able to get back to base. Then Middleton asked if we could make an airfield on the south coast of England. The engineer said, yes, we could. Right, we're going down, Middleton said. Royd, the navigator, went into the bombing well. As we neared Turin, Middleton skillfully wove his way down through the light flak and the flares. For a moment, I wondered if we were going to get entangled in the white silk parachutes from which the flares were hanging. Then we were hit by flak in the wing, which reduced our power of lift, and Middleton called for Flight Sergeant Hyder, his second pilot, to help him with the controls. We heard him say over the intercom, "We're still okay," and he began circling again among the flak. Middleton had just identified the target when a shell burst in his cockpit between him and Hyder and wounded both of them. He said, "I'm hit." Then he lost consciousness and the Stirling went into a dive. As we went down, the fuselage and the main planes were being hit almost continuously. Hyder got to the controls and brought the bomber out of the dive, but we were down to 800 feet before we felt her level out. Middleton came too while we were climbing, and his first question was whether we were too low to bomb. We could see the housetops of Turin and tremendous fires. It was a wonderful night for bombers, and we dropped our load from just about 1,500 feet and felt the thuds of light flak along the main plane at the same time. Despite his appalling injuries, his right eye had been destroyed by a shell splinter, and the bone above the eye was exposed, Middleton ordered the second pilot back to the rest bunk to have his wounds dressed. He too had been badly hit. The wounds on his face were dried with gauze, and his hand, which had been torn, was dressed with a pad, but he refused to have a tourniquet put on his wounded leg. "I want to go back and help Ron," he said. He shambled past me, head forward, looking in his determination like a wounded bear. I saw the blood stains on his green flying suit as he passed the lights on the engineer's panel, and I could not imagine how he kept standing. We thought then of flying to North Africa to avoid the climb over the Alps, but Middleton was determined to get his crew back to England. To make most of our fuel, we jettisoned everything we could: the camera, armor plating, oxygen bottles, ammunition, flares, seats, fire extinguishers, and even the sextant. Royd, the navigator, prowled around the aircraft with a fireman's axe, chopping off things to jettison. He asked Middleton whether we should drop the guns overboard. Middleton replied, "Yes, okay, George, carry on. But try not to talk to me. It hurts when I answer." We had a 4 hours flight ahead of us and the Alps to climb again. Both our pilots were seriously wounded and their windscreen was smashed in so that they were sitting in an icy gale. Sergeant Mackey, the front gunner, came back and stood by the injured pilots, setting the compass and helping them to weave their way through the passes. The time spent in bombing Turin had, we thought, reduced fuel so much that we would be lucky if we reached the sea in order to ditch. So we checked our dinghies. Then the north wind dropped a little and we made better headway. There was still little hope of reaching England safely, however, and our captain must have realized that he could have bailed out or crash-landed on the flat plain of France, but he had made up his mind to get his crew back to England, although his wounds were serious. Over northern France, I saw a flash of light above me and realized it was a reflection on the astrodome of searchlights. We were coned by about 12 of them, and more light flak hit the wings. Middleton was an artist at throwing a bomber about, and we lost height from 6,000 to 600 feet. He asked again about petrol, and just as we sighted the coast of England, the engineer reported that he could guarantee 5 minutes' fuel, but not 10. Middleton asked for his parachute, and it was passed to him by the navigator. But I believe now that this was no more than a gesture to reassure us. His voice was very thick and difficult to understand. For a moment, I went off the intercom to get a bearing, and when I came on again to announce the result, I was told that the order had been given to bail out. I went forward in time to see the second pilot's upturned face disappear, and then I went out. No one will ever know what was going on in Middleton's mind during those last few moments, but when the engines of a big bomber cut, it does not glide easily, so Middleton went out to sea, perhaps thinking that he had a better chance of ditching than crash landing. But evidently he was too far gone to alight safely on the sea. The bodies of the engineer and the front gunner were found the next day, but Flight Sergeant Middleton's body was never recovered. During the return home, there were many opportunities for us to abandon the aircraft over France and for Middleton to live, but he preferred that we, his crew, and the aircraft of which he was captain, should not fall into enemy hands. That was the kind of man he was.